sisikeleli Afrika, malu kwa kanisu kondo layo, iswa imi chanda so yetu, kosi sikeleli.
I think that most of us would say that Ubuntu basically it speaks about what it means to be human. It speaks about sharing. It speaks about being compassionate. It speaks about knowing that we are interconnected. And so Ubuntu really says, if you want to be nice to yourself, start in a way by being nice to the other.
Siten sidi basamane.
We were given the opportunity to go to Africa, first of all to interview Archbishop Desmond Tutu, but also to be immersed in a culture that none of us had ever been exposed to see what each person would define as Ubuntu. And within the entire experience, we kind of made it our goal to emphasize the learning journey as a way to personally track each of our journeys and to better understand our personal motivations and our growth throughout the process.
There's a couple pieces to this, you guys. You're really being called in a different way with this adventure.
I have given you something to do for Wednesday that's actually pretty important. I gave you all a copy of the Learning Journey rubric. If there was ever a learning journey, we're about to go on it. In particular, right now, I want you to look at the first column of the rubric, which is the call stage.
He came to us with it saying this was his idea on how to sort of, it was his rubric on how to evaluate yourself in the call, the journey, in the return phase of whatever it is that you're doing, so you can really better understand what you've gone through and how you feel about it.
As you ask yourself the questions that are in the first part in the call stage of the learning journey rubric, you're gonna be able to evaluate your preparation up to this point.
The call, the journey, and the return. And the call is when the hero goes off, and the journey is what he goes through, and the return is when he comes back to his people. And we're like, I don't think any of us are heroes. Like, what does that have to do with us? And it made so much more sense the day before we left, or the day we were leaving. The call was like, I see now how we're heroes, how we're going on this journey that's gonna change us and change how people look at us in a certain way.
So as we move into this Africa trip, we're actually moving from a cognitive preparation stage into an experiential or affective learning phase.
The preparation in terms of, well, obvious things like interviewing, that kind of thing, that was absolutely beneficial.
We had sort of like given the time to research where we were going and just look into basic details. I felt like we were so much further ahead, but sitting in our desks back home, it didn't seem like that big of a deal until we were really thrown into it.
The idea is if we're going to another culture, another country, and we're connecting with both the culture and the people and the environment, that somehow that completes us in a way that we wouldn't be completed without having this experience. So it's a very dramatic way to have the kids experience the interconnectedness that we have as human beings in the world.
I'm kind of in a bubble right now, and that's what my goals are based on. And I think by traveling to places like South Africa, will shift my goals and how I live my life.
So, just got to South Africa, and we landed in Johannesburg, and now we're driving outside the city. We have an amazing tour guide named Dawie Krause, and he helped plan this trip. And he is
constantly telling us about the history and where we are.
He basically knew Africa and led us through.
Every day we learned something new from him, and as we got to know him, we realized he really prided himself on his country and his people.
So the theme of the project is Ubuntu, and it's about the idea is that we are who we are because we're in relationship with others, that we are creating each other and being created by each other all the time.
When we say Ubuntu, we say a person is a person by the virtue of the others. And in one word in Xhosa, this is what it means. Once we said, hey, where did you get it? How do you practice? We can tell you that we have sucked it from the parents. My mom is dead. And that's what it is. We didn't have to learn it, but we sucked it. Nimone faga maplugi Maria,
nimone kubi moti Maria, nimone shijama sogi Maria. Welcome to South Africa and welcome to Cape Town, and thank you for being here. And I really believe in synchronicity, and I believe that you're here for a reason. So what we're going to tell you today, it probably is going to shock a couple of you. The reality of what the children in South Africa are living is unacceptable. And because we've got a man like Nelson Mandela and a man like Desmond Tutu, people think that we're okay here. And it's not true, guys. We're not okay here. So I think by the end of us meeting each other, it will have a profound effect on your lives. Because every single person that's sitting in this room that's not from California is from the streets of Cape Town.
My Life, which is an organization that supports kids that really want to change their life and are willing to get off the streets. They told me and Jack about their life and how they got to My Life and what the gang life was about. And then they asked us to tell them about our life. And that was kind of hard because they had just told us these really intense stories and we really didn't have anything to say.
When Lindsay talked to us, it was kind of like a huge challenge for me to watch what the kids in the room go through on a daily basis.
And they abuse me of hitting me and tell me why didn't I do my homework. Because every time they send me to the shop, I have to wash the dishes, I have to make up a bed. So I took myself a step away from them. Because I've been shot through my neck, I've been shot through my stomach, and I shot my own fingers off.
Pretty much all of them had realized what a cycle of destruction they had entered into and how they were spiraling down. They had really been given like bad circumstances and just hadn't been able to pull themselves out until they entered into the foundation and that they had turned their life around. So to see where they had come from and where they are now,
because these people who we had never met before came out and told us their life stories, as gruesome and as sad as they were. And they told us and they trusted us with these stories. And I think automatically we had a connection with them.
We come from drugs, we come from alcohol, we come from gangsterism, we come from the streets, we come from whatever. So we're gonna be there. And like, we don't care if you're on a street kid, you can be a rich kid, you can come there. We're gonna teach you, we're gonna try to help you and just get the, we're gonna try to help you find the best person inside you. We're gonna try to make you be the best you can be. If I can change you into the best you can change someone else into the best they can be.
My Life was probably the place that I think about every day, and it definitely affected me a lot more than I thought. To finally like humanize it and really meet those people face to face, and especially them, because they're people who have tried or attempted to overcome that sort of lifestyle, and then they're so strong to talk about it, those things really surprised me.
What a knowledge and what a gift nobody will take away from us. And I'm looking forward to see you again, sharing the same knowledge. Thank you, guys.
Just know that you're part of our family now, and we're part of yours. And you must know that this door is open anytime. So we love you all for being here today, and thank you.
I think that the word to describe what I'm walking away with is awareness of myself in relation to others, of myself in relation to my thoughts. Just once you've become aware of something, you can't go back.
Yeah, 40 children live with us. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take you outside and you can come and meet some of the people.
Yesterday we went to Cotlands, which is an orphanage for abused and abandoned babies. And the director showed us around. It was the headquarters. There's a couple of them around South Africa, but this was the main one. And she showed us around, and then we got to actually go and play with the kids at recess. So we went outside, and as soon as we went out there, they just ran up to us and jumped on us, and they were extremely loving and caring and adorable.
For me, I thought it was really interesting how these kids that we never knew, we've never even met, we've never even seen before, they were so like loving and open to us, and they're only like 3 or 4 years old. And it's just interesting because that was sort of the trend throughout the whole trip with the whole Ubuntu thing, and everyone was just so open, and that was sort of the launching point, I think, Cotlands with the kids.
It was one of those things where we got to meet the people we were gonna be helping out. So that was like putting faces to your work and made you think more about like how happy you were to be doing this.
Kruger Park is this huge park, and there's no civilization. It's all the eye can see is animals, trees. It's a really amazing, beautiful park. And beginning the chance to view the ecosystem of Africa was magnificent, because you were able to view these animals that were so majestic that you only read about in books, seeing Discovery Channel. It was awesome to get that part of the trip integrated into this experience.
Today we've seen 4 of the big 5, which we've seen buffaloes, lions, rhinos, and elephants. So I think we're really fortunate.
We also saw Termite Hill, which I thought was pretty cool. No one else seemed to agree.
Yahweh said that the Africa has its own like ecosystem, and it's like a world in one country.
Yeah, South Africa as a country is a microcosm for the world in so many ways, political and ecologically. They've got so much going on. They actually have snowy mountains. They have a little bit of tundra ecosystem. This Mediterranean ecosystem that we're in now occurs in very few places in the world. So your ecosystem and the plant communities and animal communities that develop have to do with where you're standing on the angle of the earth. That's where biomes develop, is due to the weather and the conditions that are in that part of the globe. So it's interesting on a lot of levels.
When a little bird is born, coming out, incubating out of the egg, you get 2 types. The one is called a runner, as it comes out of the nest, out of this process. And the other one is called a sitter. A sitter is a little tiny bird. As it comes out, it's like... Okay, so this was the first lesson, an introduction to the amazing life of birds. Okay, next up.
Right as we were walking back to the bus to go find where we were gonna sleep, it started getting dark and everything just lit up, and there were so many noises from so many bugs and so many birds that we just weren't able to see. And I thought it was a common theme for Africa because there are so many things happening there that you just can't see unless you look for it.
So the question is, while I'm on the journey, and this is, we're in a little metaphorical journey, but this is the journey of life. That's the point of this thing. So how do you evaluate your experiences and draw on your skills and knowledge? So all the preparation that we did for this trip was a way of generating certain abilities so that when you're on the trip, you'll be able to draw on those things, the mental preparation, the cognitive preparation, to enhance meaning and learning. That's it. Life is about learning and meaning, however you define it.
At first, when I heard that we were going to call into a circle and kind of talk about the rubric and share what our current states of mind were and stuff, I was a little bit hesitant because I can think quickly, but I prefer to have an experience and then let it kind of marinate for a while. But it kind of pushed me into a new place where I just had to share what was going on right then.
At that point in the trip, I sort of knew how I was feeling, but I found it extremely useful and helpful to hear everyone else's voices on like the same questions I'd been asking myself. And it really made me realize that I hadn't even like gotten a true chance to reflect.
I remember halfway through the trip just like being exhausted from so many experiences, and we took like half a day going through the rubric, and all of a sudden I wanted to get back out there and see the entire Africa.
So in the experiential or the affective part of the learning process in discernment, engaging in experiences that encourage me to challenge my assumptions and comfort levels and respond in new ways. The discernment part is absolutely the core of the class. It's everything is based on that discernment. It's being able to discriminate about your experiences.
What touched me the most was the first time we got to meet with kids our age. That was at Conquest for Life.
It was a good opportunity to get to know them and the kids over there, but it was also a good opportunity to realize the similarities between our cultures.
I think one of the most meaningful parts of the trip for me was when we visited a high school in the township of Gugulethu called Fazeka.
We were really just thrown into like this unknown world, and we were just told to talk and to be ourselves. And it's like, for me, it's how do you trust someone you don't know? And here we are telling everything about ourselves, like trying to build a connection, trying to build a friendship.
As time got on, we realized that we have so many similarities, like even with music and dance, that we can really connect.
Then we kind of had like a show and tell type deal where we would, they kind of led us in some like traditional African songs, and then we would show them like a little something that we knew or like a song that we had learned.
So amazing, and they sang for us and they danced, and we did our best to keep up with them.
And they were so passionate. One of them wanted to be a singer, and that's all she wanted to do, and she knew that that's what she wanted to do. And
they had so much passion, it was like overwhelming. And it's like you wanted to just take a little vial and bottle it up and take some home for yourself.
With all that I've been blessed with here, I found myself really envious of those students.
Those were like really awesome kids. They would be my best friends if I lived down there, so.
So for me, this is a big deal, what we're doing today. It's a tour, but it's also kind of like a pilgrimage to a site where something really extraordinary happened. There are few people in the world, and there are few stories in the world like this, in all of history, and certainly in this century. And the connection, obviously, is that Desmond Tutu and Nelson Mandela worked very closely together.
What we're gonna do first, we're gonna show you the island with all its splendor, then we're gonna take you to prison to lock you all up.
Coming to Robben Island, over a period of 400-500 years of history, this island, the island of banishment, throughout the ages, and finally it becomes the hello of South Africa. Today, we can say proudly, this is the island of peace. And we all are people of peace, aren't we?
Yeah.
Yes. We are. Now let's give one another warm welcome to the shores of South Africa, Robben Island.
Let me introduce myself. My name is Sparks. I'm your guide. He's going to take you around the prison. I'm an ex-political prisoner. I spent 7 years here on Robben Island. I was charged in 1983. And released in 1990. My charge was terrorism under Section 29. Don't be afraid, I'm not going to terrorize you.
They were freed from prison, and then they were offered these jobs as tour guides, and they were willing to tell about these things that happened, and they feel strong enough that people need to know what happened, that kind of opened my awareness.
Hearing the people who had experienced it speak to us about it made it that much more.
So now, let's proceed to Mandela's cell. Cell number 7 in B section.
The part of the trip that struck me the most was Robben Island, because it was this place where they sent all these political prisoners. And the slogan amongst themselves was, each one teach one, which is sort of their outlook on apartheid to make them stronger. So I thought that was really cool.
The thing that hit me was that they had the people who were jailers and the people who had been in prison there working together. Was one of those things that just, it seemed so much more right.
And it's this quiet road with like trash blowing by, and we are going to be separated into three groups, and instantly right off the bat I knew that what I wanted to do was go out and walk around and be exposed to this. It was like, this is what I need to do, this is what I need to see if I want to ever understand. It wasn't just seeing the houses that had an impact, but it was the people inside them, the people who would welcome us into their homes. Like, yeah, come in.
As South Africans, and let's call myself, for lack of a better word, as a white South African, we don't come to the townships enough. We don't go to the places where we need to. Then you have people coming all the way from America and they come into the townships.
It came out of the outreach program because the outreach workers, they go into each house and weigh the child. If they come across to a mother who is looking after a child and the child is underweight for age, and they have a responsibility to rehabilitate that child until they're happy with the weight. So Pilani means get well. That's the greatest wish going to the people themselves.
I'm Dombe. So I'm working here as an outreach worker. I think it's 2 years now. So I'm happy about my job because that's what I want, to help people and to look after children.
Like you guys did at Pilani, sweeping and painting and cutting grass. Yeah, you're doing it for them. But there is a spin-off for you, even just the spin-off of feeling good.
A powerful moment for me was when, at Fulani, when all the women started singing their songs, and then especially when we started singing their anthem and they joined in. We expected to go there and be the heroes because we'd raised money for them and collected baby clothes. And they're really gracious, but they gave us something that would last longer.
I've never felt what I felt when they were singing to us. I mean, and I still don't know what it was that I felt.
They gave us so much and none of it was material. And I never would have expected that that was what was going to happen.
I think that we're all going to search for that same feeling for the rest of our lives, and whether or not we find it, you know, at least we've experienced it once.
The Desmond Tutu interview was probably the thing that we were all preparing for and, like, we were all looking forward to on the trip.
So I want you to track how we're going through the preparation, what questions seem good, where your instincts tell you questions are going to work or not work, and then see how they land so that you're actually tracking your experience, because this will be the platform for the next journey. Listen in tomorrow as we ask the questions. You know what you want to ask, even if the language is a little choppy. When you're really clear in your intent like that, he'll get it. The most important thing is what we ask, he gets what we're actually asking, so he doesn't answer a different question.
Trying to come up with questions that, of course, he hasn't answered before. That's the whole point, is make him go, wow, nobody's ever asked me that before. And that was a really fun process.
It took a couple days to finally get a question produced, and it was a great opportunity to talk about all these things that so many people don't get to talk about with someone like him, like apartheid. And
before we interviewed Desmond Tutu that morning, we went to his church. You know, when he's in town, he comes to this certain church and he does his ceremony. Mm-hmm. He walks in just with this huge smile on our face, and you can just feel the energy completely change. Like, all of us, instead of nervous, we were excited, but just his presence had such a huge impact on me, and it really felt like we're in the presence of somebody important.
It seems to me that through your dedication to the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, that you have a very deep faith in humankind. And so I was just wondering how that came about and if you've ever doubted it.
Yes. I mean, after we'd been exposed to some of the most awful atrocities, people telling us some of the things that they've done. And you were quite devastated by the accounts that they gave. I thought that that was what one would take away, this feeling of just how depraved we can be. But I was surprised that that wasn't what one took away. What one took away was also a knowledge that, yes, we have an incredible capacity for the worst possible evil, all of us. It was that we also have this incredible capacity for good. Yes, and you have to, you have to say, I mean, that we have faith in humankind, that human beings are fundamentally good.
I was really nervous to ask it because I was afraid I'd like misword it and completely botch my question, but even though he gave me a lot of information that I wasn't expecting, and I thought his answer was really inspiring.
Personally, forgiveness has been challenging for me, especially when I feel like the other person that has hurt me isn't being punished in a certain way. So my question is, during the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, how were people able to let go of their anger and forgive when, without feeling like a punishment was needed?
Yes. Forgiving is not easy. You know, I mean, it's not cheap. And those of us who came to be Christians get to remember, I mean, that forgiveness cost God the death of God's Son. It's a very expensive thing in many ways. But you see, one of the things that we try to tell people is that there are at least two forms of justice. There is what is called retributive justice, and there is restorative justice. And it is tough, but I mean, people were incredible, and people, it's not a peculiarly African thing. You don't think that we have a copyright to forgiveness. It's done by people everywhere. And I hope, I mean, that you would be one of those who says, the person who has hurt me, and we mustn't pretend, I mean, that they haven't hurt you. But if you do not forgive, you actually are tying yourself to the perpetrator. But you are going to live your life as a victim, you know, and you will not be, you won't experience a liberation, the liberation that comes actually from forgiving.
The last portion of the journey is called the return. It's the integrative phase to produce, guess what? A new level of awareness, a transformation.
We've gone over the rubric a lot since we came back. And there's questions on the rubric that are questions that you wouldn't necessarily ask yourself, like if you're just by yourself. But once they're asked, you can't really get them out of your mind, even if you're not specifically thinking about the rubric. So just like asking yourself like how you felt and where it came from and why you felt that way and how you feel now, how you've changed, like it kind of really let me have some closure, I guess, because The trip was really a really big experience, but it's hard to tell people how I felt because you can't really explain the feelings. So those questions, answering them, are kind of explaining those feelings without directly going into the experience.
So the essential question at the integrative stage or the return, that's where we're integrating, you know, the cognitive or the learning skills with the experience about how we applied those skills in the process of the journey to reflect on what we got out of the journey. That's why I'm having you write these conclusions and these reflection pieces, just so you have a conversation with yourself about what mattered.
There are certain situations, like talking to the kids at My Life and the kids at Fazeka about their life and stuff, and not just kind of like shutting down and shying away from hearing all that stuff. And I think that that shows a increased capacity, because I don't think that stuff like that is easy to hear.
I think that is a really powerful element. I'm curious whether anybody else experienced that at all, a sense of realizing that you had to be open to things that might not be comfortable in order to...
I think we were in pretty extreme situations, like talking to Desmond Tutu or talking to kids that, you know, like we're not like in any middle ground. The people we were talking to were either like...
You have the exalted one and you have the...
Exactly. So I think if we can handle that, we can handle everything in between.
It was such a whirlwind. One thing, you're meeting with Archbishop Desmond Tutu, and the next minute talking with people who just haven't been out of a 400-mile radius. They've lived in Cape Town their entire life.
What touched me the most was the sense of community and welcoming that we felt when we were there. It was really amazing to see how everyone there just seemed like such a big family.
And it really brought the Ubuntu principle into place, because I could place at every part on the circle of my journey, I could place people with that. Like for the call, it was my classmates, the people I was going on the journey with. For the journey, it was the people over there, the people that I had FaceTime and interactions with. And for the return, it was the witnessing of the people at home and of myself. So that it just went full circle, and I realized all the people that were part of my journey, all the people that made it what it was for me. So
the return phase is often being overlooked. One of the things that they understand in indigenous cultures is that incomplete initiation or incomplete ritual, where people are not witnessed for how they've evolved or changed in a process, actually leads to a kind of depression, because you're not seen by your community as fundamentally changed. We look the same, we talk the same, we have the same habits, but something has changed or deepened in that process, and unless we witness it, the journey's not complete. And when we go out, part of the return is bringing what we've learned back into our community. And in some ways, it's the most difficult phase.
I think it was important to us to see our family and our community there supporting our journey and wanting to hear us.
Seeing that other people were impacted by our experience and were actually listening and internalizing what we had to say was what made it feel like I mattered, and what I did mattered, and what I experienced mattered.
The most important aspect was really learning the meaning of Ubuntu. Coming to Africa, it was, you know, it felt to me at least like that was what we were coming for, was to really gain a deep understanding of what it meant. And from the two-year-olds at Cotland to like hearing such insightful answers from Desmond Tutu, it just really seems like we got a very broad and very well-rounded definition of Ubuntu.
We all had our ideas of what Ubuntu was. We all naively thought we knew what it was before we even went. I think that once you become conscious of the fact that you are a vessel for the world, everything that you are is created by external sources. That's the moment that I decided that these were the type of people that I wanted to help define who I am and define my way of thinking. And I think that that's when I kind of, it all clicked together for me, that I saw what Ubuntu was. It was consciously deciding who and what could define me.
Ubuntu means experience to me now.
people are people because of other people. Like, our humanity is inextricably caught up in each other's. But feeling Ubuntu and saying Ubuntu are two different things. I think that's what changed for me, is that before we went on the trip, I knew the definition of it. I still feel like that definition is true, but I don't think I could explain the feelings I felt with the Ubuntu of the people of South Africa, the Ubuntu they showed to us.
And the highest praise that our people can give you is to say, you, Ubuntu. This person has Ubuntu.
I find myself now searching for anything that will sort of bring me back to the feeling I felt in South Africa.
Every time I tell that story, I kind of relive it. It reinvigorates my spirit and makes me like want to go back.
So we've made friends for life. Like the Ubuntu saying is, your door is always open. So you've got an open door in this country because you're my friends.
And so I would want to say to you young people, dream about a world that is better than our world.
I think that something that really impacted me that he said was at the end, his whole kind of dream speech about how you have to dream, and like kind of opened a new door for me, in that I just felt like I owed it to myself to kind of let my doors down and allow myself to kind of have hopes and dreams for the future.
And you know, God is forever using, especially young, not oldies like us. God likes using young people, and I hope that you will be amongst those young people who say we worked to change the world. We worked to make the world a more gentle, a more compassionate, a more caring world.
I got a lot out of what he was saying, and I'm so glad that we came all this way to interview him, and I really think it was worth it.
The idea is that we are who we are because we're in relationship with others. And what they're doing is they're taking in these impressions, and it has an impact on them.
From heaven.